start off with the second subject, the airline market. Is it a high demand for new pilots or pilots overall?
Definitely. There is a really good demand right now. If you look, you know, we can start off by looking back into history. Airline travel as measured in revenue passenger per kilometer, which is a really normal KPI or key performance indicator for the aviation industry, it has approximately doubled every 15 years, and there's no indication that it's not going to continue on that trend. The global population will be reaching 8 billion people within a few years.
Yeah.
And if you look, there's several companies who do outlooks or analysis, or, you know, it's an outlook. They're trying to predict the future somehow, but the organizations that are putting together the outlook are Boeing, Airbus, ICAO, IATA, and, you know, for those who are interested, there's a lot of information about this online, but I think Boeing and Airbus in particular are in a very good position to predict the pilot need and the technician need in the years to come. Reason for that is obviously they build airplanes, so they know how much they have in their order or in their back orders. And you can even see Boeing getting involved in a level that they've never been before. They're also getting involved in sponsoring flight training, sponsoring simulators, and they're even training pilots through Boeing to deliver together with some of the airplanes that are on order. And obviously, Boeing and Airbus has a vested interest in that we don't come to the point when there is a pilot shortage, because they can build as many planes that they want. If there are no pilots to fly them, you know, they're not going to sell any more planes. So I think, you know, if you're looking back at history, it's doubled every 15 years. Obviously, that's no guarantee that it's going to keep doing it. But there's a lot of really good indications when you look at the world economy. It's growing. In the past 10 years, the global average increase for the aviation industry has been around 5.5%. Compared to, if you look across economies, the average growth is like 2.7, 2.8%. If you talk about gross domestic product, for example. So it's almost twice as much in the past 10 years. So, you know, just to answer your question, I don't know your followers, where they're mainly from, but if you look at Europe, there's going to be a need, according to Boeing, for 106,000 pilots over the next 20 years. That's 5,300 pilots a year in Europe alone. And the Asia-Pacific region is even more, because China's got an exploding middle class. There's a lot of people who are getting more money to spare. And once they get more money to spend, usually what they want to do is go on vacation, see their families, go out flying. Chinese airspace is also becoming less restricted and more flying is available. So, you know.
For instance, when you have finished a pilot program here at Scandinavian Aviation Academy, is it hard to go out and get a first job at the airline? For instance, here at the 737 or figure out a plane.
Exactly, yeah. Well, our students over the past couple of years have done a really good job of getting hired. So we have a good reputation in the industry. A lot of our students work for Norwegian and Ryanair, even a few work for SAS. Many of the Swedish regional companies and so on and so forth. So the job market now is really good. It really is. So.
And to a follow-up question to that is that, do you need a type rating? Because that's a lot of people are asking, do you actually need to buy or finance a type rating in order to get a first pilot job?
That's two different questions.
Yeah.
The first question was, do you need a type rating?
Yeah.
And you need a type rating to work for a commercial operator, yes.
Yeah.
But the second question was, do you need to pay for it yourself, or should you buy it before you apply for jobs?
Yeah.
And to that question, I would say no.
You don't need to.
So I would say what you should do is to do your flight training at a school that has a good reputation and that has cooperation with airlines, and then focus on your training, become the best pilot you can be, and then start applying for jobs. And once an employer tells you, we want you to work for us, we fly the 737, then you're going to do your type rating with them.
Yeah.
And you have two different scenarios that could play out. One of them, the airline says, we will pay for the type rating.
Yeah.
and then you will have to sign a bond that you will stay with us for 4 years, 5 years, 6 years, something like that.
Yeah.
And then you'll have a reduced salary because they pay for your typewriting.
Yeah.
The other option is you pay for the typewriting yourself, and then you start off with a higher salary.
Yeah. So and to end up, you know, captain, first officer seat. Another question is that if you want to become an airline pilot, a lot of people out there want to become an airline pilot. Is it any way to still become, for instance, an Air Force pilot and then switch and become an airline pilot? Or is that advice that you might give to them out there if they have the opportunity?
I think the most common path is people that become an Air Force pilot,
yeah,
and then later on they transfer into the civilian world.
Yeah.
We have done some training for Air Force pilots in the past,
yeah,
who have wanted to convert into civilian licenses. So, you know, it's definitely possible and it's also fairly common. But we've also had a couple of our instructors,
yeah,
former students who have done the flight training and become civilian pilots are now doing their fighter pilot training.
Yeah.
So you can absolutely go both ways.
Yeah.
But if the
main goal is to end up in an airline, airline company and flying, for instance, a big plane, Boeing 737 or Airbus, for instance, is it better to just go through the Air Force if you can't come into the normal school or airline school? Or
I mean, I think that going through the Air Force,
yeah,
is probably more common in countries where they don't have government-sponsored,
yeah,
flight training or good financial models.
Yeah.
Because then that is the only way of getting a government-sponsored flight training.
Yeah.
Right? But when you're going into the Air Force system, one thing that you should know is that the education is long.
Yeah.
It's really good, but it also, you sign up for a lot of years before,
yeah,
you can transfer into the civilian world. It depends on which Air Force. I think in Norway, you have to stay for about 11 or 12 years before you can move on to the civilian world.
Yeah.
And I think one thing that most people, or at least most young people, don't give enough thought is that if you're going into the Air Force, especially as a fighter pilot,
yeah,
you should think about the possibility that you end up in a situation where you need to take human lives,
yeah,
which is a substantial difference from flying an airline. So, you know, people say that they see Top Gun and they think it's a cool movie, and you know, and it is, absolutely, don't,
yeah,
get me wrong, but you know, just make sure you think through those things as well. If you're going into the Air Force, there are some things you need to prepare for that you won't have to worry about in the
airline. Yeah. And you talk about the job market, that the demand of pilots really big throughout the world. What about when it comes to converting license, for instance, from the FAA to EASA, or,
yeah,
or moving to the US in order to get a pilot job? Is that something that you might recommend, or?
Well, I used to work in the United States. I did my,
yeah,
flight training there through the FAA system. I became a flight instructor, and then I worked as a flight instructor for quite a few years. So you can get a visa to do that,
yeah,
right? So if you're in the United States to work for a few years, getting a visa is a non-issue, especially as an instructor, because they really need it.
Yeah.
There's a big demand. And I had lots of fun flying in the United States. I mean, I've got some of the best flying memories ever, you know, flying over the Grand Canyon, doing steep turns over the Golden Gate Bridge,
yeah,
flying west coast to east coast in a small two-seater. All these things are just amazing flying experiences.
Yeah.
But then coming back to Europe, for me, it was easy to convert because I had so many flight hours as pilot in command,
yeah,
and I had a lot of recent experience, right? So the process for someone who has more experience is quicker, faster, cheaper.
Yeah.
But if I would have been coming straight out of flight school,
yeah,
then the process would be longer, more expensive, and so on and so forth. But I think the most important thing to mention when it comes to converting licenses is that it's usually tougher or more difficult to get a work permit in the United States for a European,
yeah,
or vice versa,
yeah,
to get a work permit in Europe for an American, than it is to actually convert the licenses.
Yeah.
You know, converting the licenses, it's a little bit of work, you gotta do some theory and stuff like that. And then I think if you are an American pilot coming to Europe, it is gonna be a little bit of an uphill to go through all the ATPL theory exams.
Yeah.
It's a lot of stuff to study.
So, yeah. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you for watching this video, and if it's any other questions, you can write it in the comment section below.